Hello, guys. So first of all, thank you for coming. I've been seeing a lot of old faces as well as new faces. Okay. Today I will be telling you several stories. Yeah. So no demo. So yeah. Stay comfortable. Okay. So sorry. Shit. Okay. Yeah, that was me 8 years ago. Hopefully, I still look the same. Okay, I work for PocketMath. We are one of the biggest mobile DSP. Yeah. So, in terms of what we do, we are doing programmatic mobile advertising. So, just a little bit background of what is actually programmatic. Mobile advertising, or in a more industrial standard term, is called open RTB, real-time bidding. So I believe all of you has, in some way, used any applications which has this advertisement banner, right? So basically, that's the area we work for. So start of the, whenever you start this application, okay, the application basically will send a request to what we call that exchange, which you can just realize it as an auction house. So then the exchange will propagate the request to several different DSPs. So now we are the one of the one. We are actually one of the DSP, demand side platform, participating in this auction. So we have to answer one single question. Do we want that opportunity or not to show advertisement here? So and also we need to give how much money we want to pay for this. And this, of course, this the pricing itself is not fixed. So it really depends on a lot of factors. So we need to do some computation. After that, the price as well as the image itself together will send back to exchange. So now we are the one participating in this auction, and the exchange will pick up the highest paid impression. Then eventually, exchange will help us to kind of deliver the image eventually into the application itself. So basically, that's how more or less RTB is doing.
What is the length of this whole thing?
Huh? Yes. So feel free to ask me any question. Okay, I try to answer as far as I know. Okay, so a good question, but basically it will be covered here. So the challenge, okay, first of all, this thing looks pretty straightforward, and it's like you guys are not doing too much things. But whenever you talk about the numbers, now this thing become a little bit tricky. So from the exchange to our servers and the back, the round trip, we have to respect 100 milliseconds latency. So beyond that, the exchange will basically cut off the connection and treat us as we are not going to buy for that. And in terms of throughput, every day we will be bombarded like 60 billion requests a day. If you do a little bit of translation, that translates like 700,000 requests a second. So by doing that, And also, we have thousands of customers and thousands of these images. So we have to make a very, very quick decision, and the throughput is also huge. So that kind of poses a unique challenge to our server infrastructure. Okay, so that's the legacy setup. Back in the old days, We were using ELB. By the way, all our servers on AWS, so we don't really host our own dedicated servers. So all the exchange traffic will first of all hit on the elastic load balancer, which will be load balanced across different bidders where we do the bidding itself. And load balancer is on the transportation layer, so it's not application layer. So basically, load balancer is just doing nothing but to shuffling the bytes. And we have an upper sheet host on the same machine with a JBoss. The reason picking arbitrary is more like we do need to have a SSL termination. So doing the SSL termination in JBoss is a little bit less robust and efficient. So that's the reason for us to pick up this setup. From Apache into JBoss, it will be like an AJP protocol. So pretty standard setup. And along the way, a lot of things start to bother us. So obviously, if you look at this graph, since these two components are hosted in a single instance, EC2 instance, we basically need to pass the request twice. First time at this layer, and once the request is passed, then it will be propagated to JBoss. I mean, basically, we need to process the request one more time, right? So this makes the processing less efficient. We are burning more CPU cycles, of course, and basically, Apache itself and the JBoss, they are also competing with the CPU cycles. And also the other one is like this thing at a reasonable overhead on the latency itself. So remember, we have like a 100 millisecond, 200 millisecond deadline we have to respect. That's including the network round trip. So really, what we have, the time what we have for processing each of the area requests is not that much. So that gives us some room to think. Then I think it's all start with the Java 7 end of the line. So we say, JBoss was on Java 7. So we say, since we are going to migrate to Java 8 anyway, why not we just do some experiment and let's say pick up a lighter weight server? So that's the reason for us to pick up Tomcat. So by doing this alone, suddenly our 99% latency goes like, whoa. Okay, so basically, that's not like a pure win. There's no right now. We have one less component to care about, the Apache. And in terms of latency, this is like a pure win for us. By the way, I'm only talking about 99% latency. So on average, it's still it was still very very fast. It's way faster than this. But again, always aim for the slowest. And the setup for Tomcat is actually very straightforward. We pick up APR, Apache Portable Runtime, as our means to terminate SSL. So, and again, since the server actually taking a lot of TCP connections at any point particular given time, so we also set a very high max connections. And yes, and that's the pretty standard setup for SSL connector. So. Basically, the rest of them just we just take it as it is. We don't do too much optimization, do too much tuning, and just dump the Tomcat there. And then we have the latency improvement, right? So it's like, oh yeah, everybody like, oh yeah, we go to party, everything looks fine. So this taught us a story. Basically, Apache itself, if you are using it as a load balancer, then probably it starts to make sense. But if you just use the Apache as like a front end for your Tomcat, then probably you don't really need that. If we can process like 65 billion requests a day, just using Tomcat alone, I think you can do that also. Yeah. So continue with the story, with the latency story. So the easiest way for us to implement a timeout mechanism to respect the 100 millisecond to 200 millisecond latency is just to throw the request into the executor service and wait for the executor service to finish. So for those of you who are not so familiar with the executor service, I'll just go to a very brief introduction of this thing. Okay, so first of all, we have the set of servlet threads which are processing the real HTTP requests. Then we'll be basically encapsulate the request itself into the task, where basically just the pipelines, and send into the executor pools, like the queue. So then the executor itself will have a set of worker threads which will be pick up the request from the queue and carry out the real actual computation itself. So this gives us a nice side effect also, like here we can also specify how many threads will be alive. That means we will have a built-in way to throttle how much load we'll be posing onto the backend, let's say database, backend, whatever the instruction we have to support for this bidding activities, right? So again, so this thing will be propagating to here, and therefore it carry out the action itself, and occasionally, okay, one of the requests will be running kind of relatively longish, not like in the seconds, but probably like 200 milliseconds, 300 milliseconds. By that definition, we don't want that anymore, because from the exchange point of view, this auction is gone. So we just reply as no bid. We are not going to buy that. So that's the executor part. Now we're talking about the task itself. The task, I skipped too fast. Sorry. So the task itself is just abstraction or encapsulation of the computation itself. There are several stages of the pipeline itself. So each stage, there are several stages which are in memory only. So those operations are very, very fast. Basically like the blue stage, basically bump into the RAM and you check some parameters and it doesn't match, I say no bid. If this stage pass, you pass on to the next stage and pass on to the next stage. As you go deeper and deeper into this pipeline, the it's getting more and more heavier. Eventually, we do have some external lookups. So we want to optimize such a way that if let's say you can already detect at this stage we have already gone through the timeout deadline. There's no need to carry on operation anymore. We just need to reply. So this has a built-in kind of way to say let's cut off the connection earlier. Cut off the request earlier. So what we decided, what we learned from the Apache story is like, because we have removed one process from the operating system, obviously there are much less context switch, because Apache doesn't need to wait for the Tomcat to respond what is the HTTP request before Apache kind of send a reply back to the wild internet. So we learned that, okay, by cutting off the number of context switches, we have a win in terms of latency. Okay, so from here, naturally, this executor, I mean, itself is just another queue built into the JVM itself. And every time we call this, we have to pay multiple context switches, because the calling thread, which is normally the servlet thread, has to wait after you submit the task. And then the executor itself will wake up another worker thread. Remember the slides I showed here? Another worker thread has to be wake up. Then once the worker thread finish, it kind of send back the signal to the original servlet thread. So that's like probably like several times of context switch, which again we learned from the Apache story. This is in our way of reducing the latency. So what we really do is like, why not we just remove the executor itself and call the task itself directly? Since we already have the pipeline built in, the built-in mechanism to terminate the request earlier, there's no big race for us to carry on the request all the way to the external resources if let's say we have already passed the timeline somewhere here. So you have already seen this slide. Yeah, so our 99% now goes even faster, going to within 10 milliseconds. Now it's like one digit millisecond latency, which is like a pure win for us. Of course, we can't really do too much on the network stack, because that's what AWS is providing to us. We take as granted. But what we can really do is like to optimize the internal latencies. Yeah. Again, so pure win. There's no additional overhead. Actually, less code also. So far, any question or do I go too fast or too slow?
Questions.
Yeah.
Why don't you terminate SSL at the
ELB? If you terminate SSL at ELB, you have to go for application layer load balancing. So ELB itself, it doesn't maintain a steady backend connection, TCP connection. It has to every time set up new connection for each and every request ELB receive. That means our server will do nothing but to kind of set up a TCP connection and tear it down. Set up another TCP connection and tear it down. So that's, we have already done some benchmarking on that, that doesn't cover us. So the only solution left to us is transport layer load balancing. Yeah. Any question? No? Good. You guys are very smart. Yeah. So let's carry on to the next story. So along the way, we have identified a very, very strange pattern. You can probably see from here. This is the server CPU. We have many, many servers. Occasionally, one of the server will go like haywire, 100% CPU, like shooting off the roof. Then what we really observed is like during this period of time, if you happen to look into the server log, everything looks fine. There's no like excessive exceptions. There's no basically no nothing. It's only the server is hitting like 100% CPU, and it kind of auto heals itself, right? Probably that's the phrase that the best bug of all the developer wants, where the bug will heal itself automatically, right? the only thing about us is like, what is happening over here? Yeah, what is happening over here? Right. So we have checked all these things, like, no clue, and it actually auto heal itself, and it's like, oh, it doesn't make sense. So until one day, we run a command line, perf top. For those of you who don't know, the perf is just a profiling tool for Linux. It's not tied to JVM itself. You can also provide native applications. So I mean, we were in a state like we have no clue. So might as well just run the command and see. So what we really see from the log of perf top is like there is a very distinct line item pointing to a garbage collector of the JDK native code. Okay, that kind of start to give us some clue. Okay, something is going on for the GC for that machine. Okay, then one of our developer James, who is the handsome boy here, yeah, he said, oh man, what if we can attach a profiler into that machine and see what is the JVM is actually doing, but the attaching profiler itself doesn't really solve the problem, but we have a good side effect. By attaching the profiler full GC was kicked out. And this full GC was actually the clue to solve the problem. Once the full GC kicked out, then you will basically see the server fever to go off, right? So this is like, oh yeah, now we have more information. So what turns out to be is like eventually we find out for the server setup we were running before, we only set the maximum heap size, so we don't really specify the distribution between the young gen and old generation. So for those who are not so familiar with the JVM memory layout, most of your allocation actually is done in the young generation. And when the GC kicks in, there are different stages of GC. So there are young generation GC, minor GC, which will be only doing something here. It will not be touching there. The reason is more like there is a paper showing that 80% of your allocations actually died out very, very young in a short period of time. They are eligible for garbage collection. So, but there are a lot of data lives quite a long time. So they just push the data into the old generation and forget about that. And then postpone the garbage collection as long as possible. What really happens is like this, since we do not specify the distribution of these two partitions of your heap, JVM is free to resize the young generation and old generation. Okay, so if you happen to read any of these performance tuning guides, they always tell you do not specify the distribution between the young generation and old generation. JVM itself has a lot of built-in heuristics to kind of adjust itself, so adjust the distribution between the young generation and the old generation, such that it go to an optimal setup. However, for our use case, it's very, very unique for us, I would say. What really happens is like the old generation keeps on growing and the young generation keep on shrinking. So then, well, the consequence is there. If the young generation is very, very small And if you are doing a lot of allocations, then we have no choice but to run a lot of minor GC, young generation collection. So this is actually the reason kind of shooting the server into 100% CPU usage. And now we kind of, okay, know the problem. The solution will be, again, very straightforward. First of all, we said explicitly give a flag for the JVM, telling the JVM do not specify, do not auto-resize the young generation and old generation, which, again, going against all the guys, but we probably have no other choice to go when the server is on fire and production is on fire and the project manager is besides you. Man, can you fix the problem? Yes, you have to say fix the problem. Yeah. So another side effect is that we discover, if we can send in a full GC command to the JVM, such that it will clear out all the old generation, and it will solve the server fever. Yeah. By the way, the server fever is more like it's a cute name for us to name that event when the server goes like 100% CPU usage, where the server is not really dying. It's just like it's not really that healthy. Also, so we decided to call the cure for this thing to be Panadon. Yeah. So turns out there's a very neat command GCMD which you can send to any JVM. And you can run additional operations. For those who you want to see, you probably can run a manual command for this GCMD to see all the options. One of the options is called gc.run. This will trigger the full GC. So the other opportunity for us to run this is because our traffic is, our main traffic is coming from the US. So that kind of gives us an opportunity where the traffic day to day goes like a sine wave. So there will be a peak, there will be low peak. So this gives us the perfect opportunity for us to kick in the Panadon.sh during the low peak. While we still get hit by the GC a little bit, well, when you do garbage collection, obviously you can't process anything. We have to time out a little bit. But at least it solved the server fever for us, right? So this is the graph after we apply Panadol here. That's the point we apply Panadol. This is a server start to having fever like 38 degree, but not that high, like 40 degree. Yeah. So we just kick in the Panadol and all these things, and you can also see a trend along the day. This is more like a daily graph. Along the day, the server start to converge the CPU usage. Why is more like the build-up effect of this old generation getting larger and larger, young generation getting smaller. But once we apply the Panadol, things like getting much better, they kind of start to converge again, which is like, okay, now we kind of solve the problem. But for this time, while we have already solved the problem, but we explicitly go against the all the conventional wisdom where they tell us do not specify a young generation. And we have like a very shitty thing like, oh, we need to have apply the Panadol daily. Well, yeah, I kind of get a job done, but yeah. So how's the time?
Good.
So any question?
So when you do the full GC, when you trigger that, is that stop the world and then you lose lots of requests?
Yes. That's the trade-off we have to make. Because otherwise, when the server goes like a fever, we'll be losing more bits, and we'll be losing more money. So might as well just lose some small money than the big money.
Does the garbage collector eat up all your CPU resources? Even if you put more, you eat up everything also?
Yes, because the new generation, the young generation, keep on shrinking. And it become to a point where every request or every top-down request comes in, we have to kick in a minor GC, which is like the main reason driving the CPU usage going up very, very high.
Have you looked at any commercial GC like from Azul?
We are more like lean towards the open source things. Yeah, so we don't really want to pay the commercial service as for now. Yeah, probably that would be a good solution for us. Yeah.
The young generation is so big, minor GCs will take longer, right?
Okay, because we are using G1 GC, So the minor GC doesn't really collect all the young generation. It's like depends on how much time it has, you collect as much as possible, but it doesn't really have to collect the whole region. So that gives us a little bit of flexibility.
Is there any memory leak in your application that you detected?
I would say no. I would say no, because after we apply the Pandora, the SH, and it go back to the similar level compared to previous day. So in terms of memory leak, that could be a possibility, but we have more or less ruled out that possibility, yeah.
Also the server check, only one server seems to go high, and the other servers are like better, not better. So is there, did you investigate that?
Sorry?
In the server, CPU user check.
Okay, during that server fever, right, the server actually, the throughput for that particular server is comparable, the same, compared to the rest of the servers. So basically that server is not like processing less or processing more data, it's processing more or less the same. Only using more CPU usage, yeah.
It's not always the same server, right?
It's a different server. Yeah, it's random. So yeah, it can't really have any high strong correlation between which server goes to fever when. Yeah. Okay? Okay, let's move on. So our traffic start to, as we approach to the end of the year, our traffic start to grow. So early last year, we start with 30 billion. Then this time, it grow to 40 billion. So as you know, anytime you have something start to grow, some new problem will arise. So this is a problem. This graph comes from the exchange. So that's the external view. How is the performance of PocketMath? Okay, so the blue line shows how much traffic the exchange sent to us. The green line on the other hand is saying that what is the percentage? This is the 50%. What is the percentage of throttling? Okay, let me give you a very brief explanation. What is the throttling? So the exchange itself, mostly they build their infrastructure very smart. So there's no way for them to know how is PocketMath doing, what is the CPU usage, right? All we expose to them is just like black box, just send me that bid request to via HTTP. So from them, they are building something like heuristically. First of all, they will keep sending as many requests as possible to DSP, so to PocketMath. And if let's say for some reason, they observe some kind of slowness in terms of timeouts. So in this case, 100 requests sent to us, 50 response goes back in time. So that kind of give them some kind of idea, say, huh, these guys probably are having problem. Let's not send that fast, let's not send that many, let's send a little bit less. So the next round, they will be sending less. So this is basically throttling. And for us, this is really a bad situation because basically we are losing from this graph, 80 requests where we can make a purchase, make some money. So this is like a missing opportunities. So obviously, throttling is bad, okay? So we want the green line always stay at the as close as zero, yeah. So right. So the other observation we have seen is since we are using ELB, ELB has its built-in matrix also. So this is something export to from ELB into New Relic. As you can see, the ELB. This is the unique TCP connections ELB has seen during that period of time. So it's kind of going up, and also the spillover. Spillover refer to where ELB has already received a request from the outside world, but haven't been able to make an internal connection to our bidders, such that it kind of like waiting for too long, and you say, oh, okay, I'll just drop the TCP request, TCP connection. So as you can see, there's a steady trend going up. So again, this kind of start to bother us, yeah. So as more and more TCP connections are established with ELB and as well as the backend server, and we have seen more spillovers. So one of the observations is like, because we have already set ELB to be keep alive as long as possible, we rule out the possibility where ELB was early terminating all the TCP connections from exchange. So the only possibility left to us is like Tomcat itself is doing something wrong. So it's kind of cutting off the connection way too early. It has to be, it's supposed to keep alive as long as possible. So then say, let's just set the revise the keep alive timeout. Remember I told you earlier before, most of the parameters we just take as using the default. Okay, we don't change anything. So then this the another parameter we change. So we make it like 5 minutes for Tomcat. So we want that connection to be stay alive for 5 minutes. So so that it doesn't terminate or destroy that early. But this makes no difference. So again, it's like okay, what okay. Then the conventional wisdom kicks in again. Okay, when in doubt, consult the doc. Okay, so okay, let's go back to the Tomcat documentation again and see what else we can do. Turns out, there is not only the time keep alive timeout, but also there is a keep alive request, a counter. So that's what really makes the difference is like keep alive will be keeping alive as long as 5 minutes, or this counter itself was default to 100 over here. So it's like either 5 minutes or 100 requests. So after 100 requests has been served over that TCP connection, gone for you. So that's the catch for us. So how do we solve the problem? Easy. Just make sure there's no counter, that there's no upper limit. So this connection will stay as alive as 5 minutes. Okay. So again, so let's quickly. So the blue line in here representing the quick deployment. Let's just deploy everything together and solve the problem. So of course, during this deployment, throttling rate goes like 100% because no server is responding during that period of time. Then after that, what really matters is like, okay, everything goes to zero. Yeah? Yeah. So a single line of configuration, change all of them, change all the, make all the difference. Yeah? So time to party? No, man. The reason is, as we are approaching Christmas, so the traffic keeps on growing. Nothing kind of can stop the traffic from sending to us. So basically, the throttling back again. This time, we know definitely it's not going to be the max keep alive request count because we have already solved the problem. And yeah, you have already seen this before. And the other observation we have already seen, we start to notice, is like for any given time, the server, okay, this is during the low peak of our traffic. So you can only see like 6,000 established TCP connection per server. So this number can go up to 10K to 12K. So there is always this pattern. It stays stable for a while. Then suddenly, it kind of like take a dive. Goes from 6,000 to like 2,000. For each line, it's like 5 seconds away from each other. So it's like within a minute, we have lost like 60% of our traffic, of our connections. So this kind of start to bothering us. And after that, this guy auto heals itself again. It's like, oh, another bug of this auto healing. So we know we have already solved more or less the garbage collector problem, right? We know we have already solved the maximum keep alive request. We go and look at the log. Everything looks normal. We go look at the New Relic monitoring system. Everything looks normal except this thing. Okay. So what we hear is we were in this state for a while, literally, until one day. When we were doing garbage collector tuning, accidentally, this flag was added for no good reason, just because we are told to. So we just add a flag. So normally, the flag will enable the logging like this, that list line. Most of the time, the time stop is like in a range of milliseconds, 5 milliseconds, 10 milliseconds, maximum like 50 to 100 milliseconds. That's like when a GC kicks in, minor GC kicks in. But what really happens is like we start to see some very strange outliers. It's like in several orders of magnitude larger than a normal one. So these start to kind of not so usual. And the other observation we have observed is like whenever we see this 4 second delay, 4 second stop, we are going to do the dive. We are going to do the deep diving here. So that kind of start to give us some kind of clue. Okay, there's something related. There's very high correlation between these two events. Whenever you see the 4, there will be a dive. So that kind of give us something to start with. So again, the conventional wisdom say when you have a problem, go and ask Stack Overflow. Okay, so let's just do some Google searching, and Google search lead us to one of these questions, which is which doesn't have many answers. There's only 2 answers. So the second answer shows us you probably want to enable a safe point statistic flag. Then the things like what is really a safe point? Okay. So again, go ask Google, and when in doubt, read the doc. Okay, the doc says whenever JVM want to do something tricky as in if let's say that you want to do a garbage collection, obviously you have to stop all the stress. Otherwise, what happens like? Still, one of the pointer is still on your stack, and the memory it's pointing to has been already reclaimed by the garbage collector. So what happens when you access that pointer again? Stack fault. So obviously that shouldn't happen, right? So the JVM will be for the safe point. Basically, it says the JVM will coordinate all the threads to stop at the same time, so that it will carry on some tricky stuff. One of the things is like garbage collection. There are many possibilities for this thing, like code reloading, and let's say compilation. When just done a JIT compile your interpreted code into binary code, you have to replace the original meta code dispatched to the native routine instead of the interpreter mode. So all these things requires the JVM to go into the safe mode, safe point where. The hotspot implementation where Oracle's one, presume all of you are using the Oracle implementation. It requires all the threads to be agree on the same safe point. So basically, that kind of like acting like a global lock. So if you again, if you happen to use Azure Zing, then their implementation of safe point is more advanced. They are more like several tiers. They can be per thread level. So because we are not using Zin, so this is something we have to live with. So when can the JVM kind of stop a thread and go into the safe point? So these are a lot of potential opportunities, right? So like block by lock. Doing blocking I/O, all these things. So let's just enable the flag. So what we really see is like okay. So there are a lot of possibilities for this reason, for this safe point reason. There's no and what we really observe is that there's no correlation between which type of the event happened. So again, we are getting closer to the problem, but there's not really a clue what is really happening. What really catches our eyes is like every time we see this log happen into the our soft log, there will be a distinct log which linked to one of our component. Internally the bidder is designed such that we'll have a central repo for all the bidding instructions, and the bidding instruction will be passed down to the compiler, which is built into the bidder itself. The compiler will do some pre-computation such that to make it fast and dump the result into the matching engine, and therefore that matching engine can take the request from outside world. So what really happened is like one of the step of this compilation is gone haywire, It was designed, it was working pretty okay until the point we have more customers, and the algorithm for that step is not linear, it's more like exponential. So it grow pretty crazy in terms of we had an array of 200 million long elements, so that kind of like consume about 1 giga to 2 gigabytes of data, and we are doing a sorting on top of that array. So kind of that's like when the JVM see this kind of thing to happen in a very tight loop, JVM tend to optimize the code to forgone all the safe point checks. So basically, you just send the thread into that loop, very tight loop, and just do the computation itself and never check the safe point. So when that happens, and all the threads has to wait for that single thread to finish, because we have to agree on the same safe point for the JVM to stop. So this actually is the real problem. So let's say, let's just do an experiment, quick experiment. Let's stop the compiler from doing any compilation. And this is what we really see. Okay, for a very long period of time, the TCP connection stays very, very, very stable. Okay, so now we know the problem. Let's just deploy the fix. After we deploy the fix, you can see on the graph is clearly something is really effective. Yeah. And the other side effect, a good side effect, is remember the Panadol, the SH, because now we start to kind of link back, connect the dots, right? So we start to realize, okay, because of this compilation stage where taking too much RAM, then for G1 GC, whenever you have a huge array, huge object allocation, you always, by default, go to old generation. It doesn't even stay in the young generation because that's one of the limitations for G1 GC. So they call that humongous object. So that object goes directly into the old generation. So this kind of, we now know the culprit of this old generation growing, young generation shrinking. And after we apply the fix for this problem, it actually solved two problems. So the other problem solved for us is like now we do not need to apply Panadol daily. So the distribution, basically the old generation stayed more or less very stable across the day. And this time one solution solved two problems. Yeah, we need to go to a party. And just before I end the talk, these are some numbers where I want to kind of show off. Yeah. So starting off the day, we are talking about 30 billion requests. Now we are handling 65, sometime even close to 70. So that's like two times the amount of traffic. In terms of number of servers, we started with like a 60, around 60, not really 60, 50, 55, 58, 59, something like that. Now we are talking about 47. That was day before yesterday. Yesterday, this number goes to 45. Today, this number goes to 41. Okay, so if I'm going to deliver this presentation one more time, you will see a much smaller number over here. Okay, and in terms of 99 percentile latency, and you can see this like 10 times better. So down here, this is one of our exchange. They send us daily report. This report sent to us like the day before yesterday. You can see the total number of requests sent to us, 2 billion. And unfortunately, we still have a little bit of timeouts, like 6,000. Yeah, and unfortunately, we still have a little bit of transfer error, like 5,000. But if you do the math, this is like negligible, right? And another graph, really, really want to show you. I know when you talk about latency, people tell you do not talk about average, do not talk about anything, only talk about 99 and the max. Okay, so I just want to show you anyway, what is our average time. So if you happen to see the average, it's like a 600 microsecond. It's not even a millisecond. Median is even smaller, so not even funny anymore. So 99 percentile stays comfortably below 10. So that's today. And yep. Any question? Any question? No?
Do you have some simulation environments where you simulate the requests, which suppose you have some
This is something we like to have, we don't have now. The reason is more like a simulation of this bit request is quite difficult, because you need to simulate the pattern and simulate all the different parameters we have to compute with. So yeah, definitely that could be something that can be something to be done, but we haven't done something yet. We haven't done anything yet on top of that. Yeah, really like to have that. And by the way, PocketMath is also hiring. yeah. Like PayPal. Okay, if you like, ping me. Yeah. Probably I will stay around for a while. And if you guys have any other questions, you can ask me in person. Yeah. Okay. Thank you.